Well, let's see. Maybe a little more history. About 20 years later, former postdoc Gerhard Stock and Michael Toss, who was future postdoc, I was a postdoc in Germany right after my degree, so I got to know a lot of young Germans. And happily, when I got to Berkeley, Berkeley was a nice place, and they sent me a lot of their students as postdocs. I've had about 15 or so over my career. First of all, many of them were really very good, and they were all basically free Germans, paying for that. So, anyway, when Stock got back to Munich, he had Toss gave a different derivation. They said there's another way to, actually, this is a cleaner, really more rigorous way to derive. Suppose we start with a quantum mechanical Hamiltonian operator. Given the Dirac electronic matrix, this is the nuclear momentum operator. These are creation dilation operators. This is a very simple second quantized version. They create and destroy population in electronic states, I and J. And then, you don't, if I have time, I'll discuss it. You don't have to do this next step, but it's the way Schwinger did it, and therefore, anointed by holding to holy dust. He says, suppose we take the underlying degrees of freedom of these creation annihilation operators to be harmonic oscillators, bosons. Well, we don't, bosonic symmetry doesn't enter into this. Then we know what the Rayleigh and Lorentz operators are for our harmonic oscillator, freshman quantum mechanics. And in terms of the Cartesian coordinates for the oscillator, these are the raising and lowering operators, again, for each electronic state. And if we replace A and A dagger by these Cartesian-like expressions, we get this Hamiltonian operator, which you remember is identical to the one that the classical version that Dieter Meyer and I kind of hooked up from the suit of our pants. The point is that this is an exact Hamiltonian for the full hybronic system. Put it in the Schrodinger equation, you get the exact result. The approximation, of course, that we treat classical, we treat all the degrees of freedom classically. And that's clearly an approximation, but we know historically a lot of tricky ways to use classical, even just classical calculations to mimic various phenomena. So that's sort of the model. Let me mention this. If you take that classical Hamiltonian and look at the force on the nuclei, so R dots dHdP, P dots dHdR, so that's U R double dot, and then written back in terms of the original electronic amplitudes, you see this is the Ehrenfest force. It's the coherent average over all electronic states of the derivative of the electronic matrix. So these trajectories generated by this Meyer-Miller Hamiltonian really are Ehrenfest trajectories. So that's caused a lot of people, probably nobody present in the audience, over the years to say, and when I say a lot, five or six, it's a small community of people that have used this, and they say, Meyer-Miller, that's Ehrenfest. Well, it's right in the sense that it is Ehrenfest dynamics, but it's not Ehrenfest. Why isn't it Ehrenfest? The overall approach is not Ehrenfest. Well, it's because of zero open energy. Without the half, without zero open energy, that would be exactly Ehrenfest. And if it were Ehrenfest, then there's only one trajectory. In other words, the initial conditions or the initial occupied state is one, and that has a phase. But all the unoccupied states, n is zero, and zero doesn't have a phase. So the initial conditions would be the occupied state, but if it's only one phase, that's the same as having no phase. So, and there would only be one trajectory. When you choose the initial actions, there are no angle variables to choose. There's only one, and it's irrelevant. So there's only one trajectory, and that average trajectory will not end up on one potential surface or the other. And that's the big defect of the Ehrenfest procedure. But by getting all these, but we know from just historical treatment of vibrations, you do better mimicking quantum mechanics, and even if you give unoccupation their zero point, or at least some fraction of their zero point energy, once they have zero point energy, then the initial, and then there's a phase for each electronic state has a phase. So now we have an ensemble of conjectures. So if we have start one initial state, we have n up, and then we have n phases to choose. Do that 1,000 times, generate an ensemble of there. Some of those trajectories will end up on surface one, or in its vicinity. Some of the other of that ensemble will end up on surface two, and then we get the probabilities of being on the Earth by saying what fraction end up on this surface, what fraction end up on that surface. And so the contributions to trajectories to different final states come from totally different trajectories. So each final state has its own ensemble of trajectories, the one that end up on that surface, and so forth. So it's all in the boundary conditions. And that's why it's not matter. Invested in makes a world of difference. Okay. So that's the first step. So there are really two steps to this overall modeling. So first of all is how do you describe electronic degrees of freedom classically, and that's what we can describe. The next step is, now how do you get electronic states? We want to calculate transition probabilities from one electronic state to the other. We need to sort of quantize those electrons. We need to kind of re-quantize. And we do that, this is really a semi-classical input. The quantum states of a harmonic oscillator in Bohr-Sommerfeld quantization, WKB, are corresponding to integer values of the classical action. N equals zero, when you require the action to be an integer, that defines the energy level for harmonic oscillator actually exactly. So you really, if you want, and so you see in this model, if we have two electronic states, we have two electronic oscillators, and one of them is, and it corresponds to 1, 0, and the other one is 0, 1. So electronic transitions are by electronic states, just like adding vibrations to the problem. We have 1,000 nuclear degrees of freedom and 3 electronic states. Now we have 1,003 classical degrees of freedom. We've just added 3 vibrational degrees of freedom into the problem. And that's why this approach is attractive, because if you can do an MD simulation on a protein or a nanocluster, some thousands of atoms, if you only have a few electronic states, and of course the hard part is if you have the potential surfaces, that's always the hard part. But if you have those, doing the dynamics in this model is a trivial extension. It's just adding a few degrees of classical degrees of freedom to the problem. So let's just talk about how do we do this. For our moment, let's go back to ancient history. How do we treat vibrational? So again, electronic transitions from 1, 0 to 0, 1. That's just like vibrational energy transfer in this picture. It's very, very, as I said, this is simple stuff. How did we do vibrational inelastic transitions in the old days? Well, there's a rigorous way to do that came out of early semi-classical. And really, we want trajectories to go from one quantum state, from one integer value, the initial action should be an integer. That's that initial vibrational state. And the final action should be an integer. But that won't usually happen. If you begin a trajectory with some initial action and some initial angle, and you run that trajectory, the final action will not necessarily, in fact, it will be guaranteed not to end up exactly at an integer. So you have to, it's a nonlinear boundary value problem, which is a nasty thing to do, particularly in the higher dimensions. And in the old days, we did it by a very primitive something called the shooting method. You start with the initial integer, that's easy. You choose many different initial angles, and then run many trajectories, and you plot the final action versus the initial angle, and then you pick out the initial angles for which the final action is exactly the integer of the final state you're interested in. In this case, it'd be 2. And semi-classical, there'd be interference effects between, but we won't be. We're not doing semi-classical in this problem. And in the classical approximation, the transition probability is the Jacobian, the derivative of this, the slope of this function of evaluated at the value of Q1, or which then makes the final action in any Q1. Now this is exact classically, purely classically, but it's not the most useful because it has singular, you know, for values of a final action up here at the top, that slope is zero, and this goes to infinity. That's kind of like being at a classical turning point in a WKV wave function. It diverges. It's qualitatively correct. It's a remnant of the Franck-Condon peak in the wave function. And actually, this infinity is basically a vibrational rainbow effect. Jim heard all this stuff thousands of times. And that's qualitatively correct, but infinity is not a nice approximation to me. So you actually do better classically. You smear things out a little bit. You take this quantity and average it over the final action from the integer plus minus a little window, say gamma. Now if you integrate over into this quantity, see that's exactly the Jacobian to make a change in variable, cancel these dn2s, the dq1 comes upstairs, divided by 2 pi. But now you need a little window function here that picks out the range of q1 values for which n2 is within this plus minus gamma window. And then typically this average over an angle is done by Monte. So you choose 1,000 values of these. And in the old day, this is exactly what people were doing actually when I was a beginning graduate student, before my time. They would begin trajectories at an integer value of the action, they'd run them. It wouldn't end up as an integer, but they just had a little set of boxes or bins around a box 0, around 1, around, and then the trajectory would land someplace. They'd run 1,000 trajectories, 200 would end up in this bin, so 200 over 1,000 was the probability of being in that final vibrational. It was just getting a histogram distribution, and you got all the final vibrational states from that one batch of trajectories. That was cut to be called the quasi-classical trajectory method. Very, it's still used today by a number of people. And it's not bad. One of its defects is that it's not microscopically reversible. If you do the calculation backwards, beginning at some integer here, right, at some, say, integer 2, and then run the trajectories backward, and then histogram those, you get a different result. And there were papers written by this in the early, Don Trudarm, George Schatz, Joel Walbrook, a lot of all Cooperman students wrote papers about which ways it's better to do it. They should be the same. When you do it both ways on average, well, you know, there's a whole bunch of well, another answer to that, we gave it in later in the 70s, we said, well, if you really want to make this microcosmic first, you average over the final action, you should also average over the initial action. With this little window function, it picks out the range of initial n's around its integer value. So now, if we put h-bar back in the problem, this would be 2 pi h-bar, and you recognize this as a phase space average. And phase space averages are manifestly invariant to when you do them. You can do the phase space over average over initial conditions, or the phase space average over final conditions, and then you're back. The integrand is the same. The integrand doesn't change. You have a window function for the initial action, etc. So this is what something I suggested in kind of the later 70s, and for reasons I probably don't have time to describe. We tried it on a simple example. It gave terrible results, but it's been revitalized in a way that gives wonderful results. It's weird, anyway. But we refer to this as the symmetrical quasi-classical model. It's a way of imposing Bohr-Sommerfeld quantization on the initial within a little window, not exactly quantized on the integer values, but a little window about the quantum values. That's the stuff. Symmetrical windowing idea. As I said, let me skip eight plus eight. We've applied this, so we want to apply this to, well, Steve, right? Well, this is kind of fun to talk about. We did apply this. Oh, no, this is interesting, too. When you get older, you tend to ramble, right? Well, how would you do this quantum mechanically? What's the quantum transition probability? When you start in the initial state, you time evolve it with the propagator. T of being in some finite state, until you just project onto that finite state and square. And then you just keep going at any time you want to. You don't stop and reinitialize. You just keep propagating coherently forever from that initial state. And at any time you want the probability, you just project. Well, now, let's write this down in its complex conjugate. And then you recognize this can rise the projection operator onto the finite state. Heisenberg, time evolved. And then if you bring this cat around with this bra, stick it in a trace, that's the projection operator onto the initial state. So it's a time correlation function. The initial projector at time zero, time evolved projector at time t. And now you see that's exactly the same structure as a symmetrical quasi-classical. The trace has become a phase space average, which is the classical transcription of a trace. These projection operators are these little window functions. This is the little window function of the initial state. This is the window function of the time evolved action variable. And so it's exactly the same structure of calculation. There's no surface hopping. And all through the whole calculation, it's coherent. You have a coherent, all electronic states evolve and they're propagating coherently by this Ehrenfest equations of motion from their initial conditions. And then they're quantized at time t. You want to know the probability of being in any given state. You just ask how many of the actions are in this window, how many of the actions are in this window at time t. And then you just keep going through another. You don't stop and reinitialize or anything. You just keep propagating coherently, and each time, some actions go out of one box into another, etc. So it's a very, very primitive, but it's just classical MD, starting out with some initial event and then collecting them at various times along. So it's a very straightforward and a very simple procedure. Steve initially, I said, we tried this whole symmetrical quasi-classical idea a long time ago, applied to H plus H2, which was, in ancient history, was the benchmark. We all apply everything. It was like spin boson model nowadays. But when we did it, I thought, this is collinear H plus H2 reaction probability versus energy. Points on the quantum results, which you can generate on your iPhone now, probably. The old unsymmetrical quasi-classical Lamarck Karpov specs, the red curve, and it's qualitatively correct. The green curve, I thought by averaging over the initial action, that I would average out this threshold and make it look better, but actually it did average it out by much, much too much. This was reported in a 1973 Faraday discussion, but only in the discussion. It wasn't worth putting in the paper. We didn't want to advertise it too much, but it made some terrible results. But that's mainly because in the old days, these windows were always plus minus a half. That's the, because that fills up all the space. But in the last decade or so, the theoretical name is Martin Bonnet. University of Bordeaux, he was doing just plain old-fashioned quasi-classical, but he found that he was getting better results if he shrunk the window. Actually, he didn't use history, he used Gaussian windows around each island. The main thing was that he shrunk them down. And so, if you shrink them down, let's try Bonnet's idea of shrinking the windows, but in this symmetrical fashion, and just see. Go back to even H, see if you can get any idea. Just take gamma as a parameter. I said, chemists, don't mind parameters. Think of DMT. It's got dozens of parameters. So he found out that if he shrunk the windows down to about half size around the integers, he got this blue curve. He's getting even a little bit of this tunnel. Now, there's no tunneling in this, it's all this classical. But it's mimicking the threshold behavior, and agreeing, and it does get certainly better agreement with the quantum results. And if
never thought of that.
You know, trivial. I also mentioned if you use vigor, for the theorists here, particularly, if you use vigor functions, if you use vigor functions for the window functions, this would actually be exactly the same as the classical vigor model. And it gives terrible results. So sometimes the vigor functions work well, but sometimes they're really quite poor. But then, of course, I told Steve, nobody cares anything about H plus H2, but if this business worked for these electronic oscillators in the old wire or Hamiltonian, now that would be interesting and even maybe useful. So that's what I'll describe now. So that as Steve put this together in about 3 or 4 weeks, he was generating all the equipment. First of all, he's very good. And also, this is really very, very simple, straightforward. Well, so we first did these little toy problems that John, Tully had. A lot of people start out with these when John was devising his the latest version of his surface hopping model. These are the potential curves as a single grid. So this is one dimensional, one clear grid, just scattering. It's a scattering problem. Simple curve crossing problem, which is of course trivial. There's a double curve crossing problem, which is interesting because in a semi-classical picture, if you come in from here, and if you cross here and not here, that would be one classical trajectory. And if you come in and don't cross here but cross here, that's another. And semi-classical, you would add amplitude with a phase and square, and the cross terms would give you an interference term, so-called Stueber oscillations, a quantum coherence effect. So that's interesting. And so Steve did find out, and I said, well, just play with gamma and see if you find anything that works well. Gamma has to be between, if gamma goes down to zero, these windows shrink down to delta functions, and you go back to that classical Jacobian pattern. So that's too small. Gamma can't be bigger than a half, because then the windows overlap, and they can't do that because the projection operators are supposed to be orthogonal. So between zero and a half, and he found out the results depend on gamma, he found out that gamma's of about, in the middle range, about 0.3, 0.4 or more at best. But then we actually had a little theoretical justification. I won't take time. If you have just two states, the sum of the two actions is conserved. So if you set that to 1, and then do just a sum and difference transformation, and replace N1 and N2 by the sum of their difference, this one is conserved. You reduce the problem just to 1 degree of freedom for the two-state case. And then it actually turns out that's exactly equivalent to a spin 1/2 Hamiltonian. And when you go through that, I won't take time to do it. It turns out that the value for gamma, this gamma parameter, is directly related to what you choose for S squared for spin 1/2. So what are the possibilities that come to mind? Well, totally classically, for spin 1/2, S squared is 1/2 squared. And then the square root of that is 1/2. So that's again a zero. That's when you shrunk to the, and that is correct, totally classically, but not useful. There's this so-called Langer correction. That's a very popular semi-classical thing. A lot of you know this. When you have orbital angular momentum in a problem, L times L plus 1, it often works better semi-classically when you replace that by L plus 1/2 squared. So if L is 1/2, 1/2 plus 1/2 is 1, square root of that 1, minus, so that's the maximum gamma. And that's too big. One other possibility that comes to mind is the prong value for S squared. 1/2 times 1/2 plus 1, 3/4, root 3 over 2, minus 1/2. 0.366. So I said, Steve, that's our Goldilocks gamma, it's 0.366. And so all of the results I'll show you probably will be with that choice for gamma. So here's the single curve crossing problem compared to the quantum results. And you see, of course, it's not perfect, but it does very well. This is the double curve crossing problem. This is more interesting because you see it's getting these, this is transition probability versus energy. You see it's getting these Stueber oscillations. Again, not perfectly, but extremely well. And then people find that weird. How? This is totally classical mechanics. How can you get these quantum coherence effects? Totally classical. And then people say, well, like me, they say, well, it's because you've got this molecular Hamiltonian, and then already built in the fact that you've got two states, and then you made a classical version of that. And then if you remember earlier, I did point out that he had a fixed nuclear trajectory, and just in the classical mechanics of the action angular bridge, you'd be getting the same as the time dependent Schrodinger equation. So the point is that you get coherence effects, all quantum effects in the electronic degrees of freedom, approximately, but you don't get quantum effects in the if this was a diffraction oscillation where you had the two slit problem and nucleotide meeting, etc. You wouldn't get those diffraction oscillations, correct? But you do get coherence effects in the electronic degrees of freedom in this model. Okay, so then we went to a whole different family of these spin boson problems. Which I'm sure a number of people in the room have done problems involving this. You know, it's a model of two electronic states coupled to many nuclear degrees of freedom, but they're all harmonic. They're typically shifted in position by some amount, and maybe shifted in energy by some exothermicity, epsilon, or not. And Steve has really done many dozens of these. There are hundreds of these in the literature. You can't do them all, but we have done quite a number. And there are many different, and you have a whole set of parameter regimes, and for example, this is one parameter regime where they say the electronic coupling, say H12, is really quite large. So again, the two electronic states are these two oscillators, states 1,0 and 0,1. They're coupled, and so the excitation hops back and forth between them. If the coupling is large, it hops back and forth rapidly. And so, this is applying the population difference in the symmetric case. So you get oscillate. Ultimately, they are dephased by the coupling to the nuclear path and the difference goes. Now, you see, it's not perfect. The classical results are dephasing a little faster than the quantum results, but it's still reasonably good. This is the case I've obviously where say H12 is smaller. So the hopping is much slower, so it hops once and is thermalized and never hops back. So this is the nuclear. So again, this is quantum coherence effects. Again, we don't put in any coherence or decoherence into the model. That's just coming out of the dynamics. There's nothing you have to add to it. That's where decoherence comes from. It comes from coupling to the other degrees of freedom in the system. But that's what the simulation is supposed to tell you, not this is in some asymmetric cases where the population difference goes to the ratio of Boltzmann factors, the coherent and incoherent regimes. And there, as I said, there are really dozens and dozens of these. This is a model of a paper of David Coker and colleagues on electron transfer. Electron transfer is not exactly, it's two electronic states, the nuclear. One special nuclear degree of freedom, the so-called solvation coordinate, and it's coupled to a harmonic path. These are models that Rudy Marcus used. So they play rate constants versus this case versus coupling strength. This is volume versus the electron exothermicity. And the question was, could you describe the Marcus turnover inverted regime? So you know this. I think you know the story. This is when the oscillators are degenerate; they're shifted in position. They're energetically degenerate. So there's an activation energy to getting to the crossing region, and then as you make this one, say, a little exothermic, the crossing point goes down, and the rate goes up. And when you make it, shift it down enough. So then it goes right to the minimum. Then, if this is the donor, then there's no activation energy, and that's the maximum. And then you shift it down even more, and then the crossing begins to climb up on the back wall, and then the rate goes down. And Rudy got a Nobel Prize for that. So there's hope for all of us. So the point is that Steve's calculation is exactly the same. You don't have to put anything special in. guy just died anyway. It was, and then Sharon Hammond Super had some protest. It's, again, it's, these are models. Again, two electronic states, one special cord, and then you put a proton cord in it, and it's coupled to a harmonic band. And the different parameters to the Sharon tree. And this is one of her early papers. She's done so much work since then. But and again, it's not perfect, of course, but it's you know, pretty good job of that also. This is a model. This shows two pictures at one time. It gets me confused. So. This is a model that one of Graham Fleming's postdocs, he developed an algorithm called a hierarchy equation for the motion method that really generates the exact quantum results if you iterate it to consistency. But it's only specialized to spin boson, and only for a special spectral density, the so-called Debye spectral density. But nevertheless, for those for that class, it gives the exact quantum benchmark results. And so again, many different parameter regimes. And again, you know, this model worked much better than I ever expected it to work. But you know, that's okay. You know, that obviously the coherent regime, quantum coherent, and Graham Fleming, of course, is going to make a great deal of popular literature about coherence effects in biology. And I'm trying to get into that discussion. And then some more parameters.